And the Sunday Peace Program. So we'll have for the next 45 minutes or 40 minutes a class on Bhagavad Gita as it is. And at 6 o'clock, Vasudev Prabhuji. What happens at 6?
We have an offering at 6 o'clock. And then we have Arati as part of the 6. First to the deities, and then later we have another Arati for Girida.
Okay.
And then we have Prasada. And then we sing the Dhammarashtaka, and then we have Prasada.
Okay. So there will be, at this Anukut offering, there will be kirtan, starting at 6?
No, you have to apply for 6.
Oh, all the way to 4 o'clock. Okay. 1 hour now. So, Hare Krishna, we'll read from the Bhagavad Gita, as it is, chapter 9. This is called the Most Confidential Knowledge. And the text is number 29. This is a very suitable verse for today's Govardhana Puja meditation, where Krishna says, Samoham sarva bhuteshu na me dveshoshti na priyaha ye bhajanti tu mam bhaktya maito tesha chapyaham. Well, we can repeat this together. Samaha.
Samaha.
Equally disposed.
Equally disposed.
Aham.
Aham.
I.
I.
Sarva bhuteshu.
Sarva bhuteshu.
To all living entities.
All living entities.
Na.
Na.
No one.
No one.
Me.
Me.
To me.
To me.
Dveshaha.
Dveshaha.
Hateful.
Hateful.
Asti.
Asti.
Is.
Is.
Na.
Na.
Nor.
Nor.
Priyaha.
Priyaha.
Dear.
Dear.
Ye.
Ye.
Those who.
Those who.
Bhajanti.
Bhajanti.
Render transcendental service.
Render transcendental service.
Full.
Full.
But.
Mam.
Mam. Unto me.
Unto me.
Bhaktya.
Bhaktya.
In devotion.
Mai,
Mai are in me.
Are in me.
Te,
te
such persons.
Such persons.
Teshu,
teshu
in them.
In them.
Cha,
cha
also.
Also.
Api,
api
certainly.
Certainly.
Aham,
aham.
I.
I.
Translation and purport by His Divine Grace Nisi Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki
Jai.
I envy no one, nor am I partial to anyone. I am equal to all. But whoever renders service unto me in devotion is a friend, is in me, and I am also a friend to him. Report by His Divine Grace, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki
Jai.
One may question here that if Krishna is equal to everyone, and no one is his special friend, then why does he take a special interest in the devotees who are always engaged in his transcendental service? But this is not discrimination, it is natural. Any man in this material world may be very charitably disposed, yet he has a special interest in his own children. The Lord claims that every living entity, in whatever form, is his son. And so he provides everyone with a generous supply of all the necessities of life. He is just like a cloud which pours rain all over, regardless of whether it falls on rock, land, or water. But for his devotees, he gives specific attention. Such devotees are mentioned here. They are always in Krishna consciousness, and therefore they are always transcendently situated in Krishna. The very phrase Krishna consciousness suggests that those who are in such consciousness are living transcendentalists situated in him. The Lord says here distinctly, Maite, they are in me. Naturally, as a result, The Lord is also in them. This is reciprocal. This also explains the words yeyatah mam prapadyante tam tatraiva bhajamyaham. Whoever surrenders unto me proportionally, I take care of him. This transcendental reciprocation exists because both the Lord and the devotee are conscious. When a diamond is set in a golden ring, the diamond is glorified. The Lord and the living entity eternally... When a diamond is set in a golden ring, it looks very nice. The gold is glorified, and at the same time, the diamond is glorified. The Lord and the living entity eternally glitter, and when a living entity becomes inclined to the service of the Supreme Lord, he looks very... he looks like gold. The Lord is a diamond, and so this combination is very nice. Living entities in a pure state are called devotees. The Supreme Lord becomes the devotee of his devotees. If a reciprocal relationship is not present between the devotee and the Lord, then there is no personalist philosophy. In the impersonal philosophy, there is no reciprocation between the Supreme Lord and the living entity, but in the personalist philosophy there is. And the example is often given that the Lord is like a desire tree, and whatever one wants from this desire tree, the Lord supplies. But here, the explanation is more complete. The Lord here is stated to be partial to the devotees. This is the manifestation of the Lord's special mercy to the devotees. The Lord's reciprocation shall not be considered to be under the laws of karma. It belongs to the transcendental situation in which the Lord and his devotees function. Devotional service to the Lord is not an activity of this material world. It is part of the spiritual world where eternity, bliss, and knowledge predominate. Once more, the verse reads, Samaham sabhabe bhuteshu na me dvesho shti na priyaham evadantitumam bhaktya maititeshu chapyaham. I envy no one, nor am I partial to anyone. I am equal to all. But whoever renders service unto me in devotion as a friend is in me, and I am also a friend to him. Mukam karoti bachalam bhagamunayate girim yakripatrahum mande shri gurundinatadunam. So, the first point, Samoham Sarvabhuteshu, is that everyone is related to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Elsewhere in this Gita, Mama Aivangsa, Krishna says, they're all part and parcel of me. Angsa means limb. So, Srila Prabhupada in the Purport gives the example of father and son. So, son or child is also like a limb of the father and mother, parent. That relationship can be so close and endearing that practically it is like sharing the same body. So this is a very, very apt analogy that we are all related to Krishna. And Krishna says, Samoham. Sama means same. There's no high or low from Krishna's point of view. This is what is important, because this is Krishna speaking. Samoham, sarvabheteshu, says, I am equal to all living entities. I don't make distinctions. Na me dveshoshti, na priyaha. It is not that God, for some mysterious reason, he likes some particular person. And for another equally mysterious reason, he doesn't like someone else. And that is the reason that one person we see in this world seems to be very well situated, and another person seems to be very unfortunate. Some people, they speculate like that. They are so bold as to point the finger at God. And this is actually this is just a reason for becoming an atheist. First you say, if there is a God, then he's not fair. And so how can there be such a God? There is no God. You see? But this is wrong. This is wrong. As Prabhupada explains here, there are two levels of relationship that are going on. So, the Lord is equal to everyone. That is a fact. But, in this material world, the living entities, they're ignoring Krishna. They have turned away. Krishna, bahirmukaham. Bhogavanchakari, as it is stated in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, they have become bahirmukh. Bahir means they have turned their faces away from Krishna. Why? Bhoga vanchakari. They have an interest in bhoga, in sense gratification. So as soon as one becomes too much interested in pleasing the senses, then he forgets God. That's natural. That anyone can understand. Because God is the real center of our attraction. But if we think, no, I want to be independent, I want to enjoy myself separately, then we have to put God out of our minds. That's very natural. So the more one becomes eager to gratify the senses, then naturally he becomes less Krishna conscious. So this is the misfortune of living entities here. Krishna is equal to them. Krishna holds everyone dear, in a transcendental sense, as his parts and parcels. But in this material world, we have turned away from Krishna, bhogavan chikari, desiring sense gratification instead, and therefore, nikata sta maya japati udhari. We have become seized by maya. We are under the modes of material nature, and it is because of the modes of material nature, our actions and reactions in those modes, that therefore some of us are high, some of us are low, and some of us are in between. Three modes, three levels, high, middle, low, automatically. These are created, and Krishna says, he says, don't blame me, very clearly in his Gita. I have nothing to do with these actions and reactions in the modes of nature. Prakriti kriyamanani guna karmani sarvahasha. The activities of the living entities, they're going on by these modes of nature. Karanam guna sangasya. And we, who are actually pure spirit soul, we are associating with these modes. Because we want to gratify our senses, the modes are offering us bhoga, and we associate, we identify with the modes. That is how we come to think, I am this body. What is this body? It is just three modes of nature running on, yantra, machine. But I am interested in this body because there is sense gratification possible. So then I identify so much, I think I am the body. And if the body suffers, I think I am suffering. And then I wonder, why am I suffering? Well, we have created this suffering ourselves. Because for everything we do in under this karma, there is a penalty. There is also maybe reward if we do good things. But we will also do bad things inevitably. And so therefore we have to suffer. And that is our fate here in the material world. So the point is that we cannot blame Krishna for that. Krishna, he is looking out for us, he is with us in the heart. You see, here we are, in this body. We don't have to talk too much about the body. Everyone knows that actually inside the body is not very pretty. Maybe outside it's pretty, but inside, not a very nice thing. It is full of aches and pains. It is getting older and older. And one day it will become incurably diseased and die. And so ultimately this body is a place of misery. So, but Krishna, nonetheless, he doesn't have to, but he has chosen to be with us in the heart of this. He is not, of course, sharing in the pleasures and pains of this body, but he is there to give us help. He is waiting for that time when we will turn back to him. That is how equal he is to everyone. So again, our problem is that we have turned away from Krishna. So what Krishna is saying here is that I'm with you. I'm with you. Don't think I'm not here. Don't think I'm punishing some and rewarding others that I like, dislike. No, I'm with you all. I'm equal to you all. But, then in the second part of the verse, ye bhajanti. Now this word bhajanti, Srila Prabhupada has translated this as render transcendental service, transcendental. What does that word mean? Transcendental means above. Above what? Above the three modes of nature. So there is another order of relationship with Krishna that is above the three modes of material nature, and that is referred to here as bhajanti. devotional service, transcendental devotional service. So this is also Krishna's invitation. This is Krishna not talking in this verse about some exclusive club. There is a select group of my devotees, and if you're fortunate enough to be in this group, then you're really on the in track with me, special relationships, special favors. But if you're not in the in crowd, well, too bad. Sorry, that's just the breaks. That's not what Krishna is saying. Krishna is saying, as Prabhupada translates here, but whoever renders service to me, it's open. We just have to do this. Ye bhajanti tumam bhaktya, render devotional service to Krishna in devotion, bhaktya. Then maitetesu chapyaham. Then that one becomes a special friend to me. And I become a friend to him. So then, this, you see, the modes of material nature are removed. And there is this intimate flow of bhakti rasa. Just like Srila Prabhupada explains, three modes of material nature. There are also three modes of spiritual nature. This is the hladini shakti, the potency of transcendental ecstasy. There is the sandini shakti, the potency of unlimited knowledge. And there is sandit shakti, the potency of eternality. We shorten this as satchit ananda. This is the nature of the spiritual world. So there are three modes of the transcendental nature. And within these three modes, there are rasas, there are mellows, divine transcendental mellows of relationship with Krishna. And so when one comes out of the grip of the lower modes and comes into the spiritual nature, then this is experienced, this exchange of loving relationship and intimacy. And this is what Krishna is speaking of here. So this is possible for everyone. Not just possible. Krishna, Prabhupada said, he actively comes to canvas. He comes in so many ways. He comes as Krishna himself. He comes as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He's coming today as Govardhan, Govardhan Hill. This Govardhan Puja. What is this? This is an opportunity. Yeva janti tumam bhaktya, to render devotional service. Everyone who has bathed Lord Govardhan today, this is what you have done. Yeva janti tumam bhaktya. That activity is not under the modes of nature. Of course, we may find ourselves under the modes of nature. We may find that that is our situation in general, that we're very overpowered by the modes of nature. But here you have come to this temple, and here you have bathed Giriraj. That activity was not under the modes of nature. And Krishna says, now you are my special friend. Now, there is a special relationship. The door has been opened to that. So this means that Krishna, even, again we may slip down, but Krishna will not forget. And because Krishna is the master, Shaktiman, the master of all energies, material and spiritual. So he is particularly arranging the destiny of his devotee. This is the meaning of this. He's a friend, he's in me, and I'm also a friend to him. Krishna is particularly arranging the destiny of his devotees so that they will come closer and closer and closer to him. Whatever obstructions may be there in our life that tend to separate us from Krishna, they will be gradually removed. You see? And this experience of rasa will become ever sweeter and sweeter and sweeter. So this is the Lord's indication in this verse. So here, as we can see, Krishna is not, this is not exclusivity. Krishna is not keeping this a secret. He's proclaiming it in Gita, and moreover, he's active, as we see, this Govardhana Puja festival. This is Krishna taking the initiative. He's taking the initiative. He's appearing here so that we can serve him. And he doesn't care who you are, where you've been. You may have come here first time. Or you may have been here so many times. One may have bad habits. No consideration of that. Just come. Bathe me. come, chant Hare Krishna. What is, how naming, how intimate that is. How intimate that is. He's saying, come on, name me. Come on, enter into this transcendental affair, transcendental love affair with me. So this is Krishna's mercy. As Srila Prabhupada so nicely explains, that the Lord here is stated to be partial to the devotees. This is the manifestation of the Lord's special mercy to the devotees. And Chaitanya Charitamrita, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is stating, Jivera Surup Hoy Nityara Krishna Das, that the actual Surup of every living entity is that they are eternal devotees of Krishna. So ultimately, Krishna in this verse, he is actually not speaking in two categories, really. He's saying, I'm there in the heart of anyone. And there's a reason why he's there. The real confidential reason is that he's, by his presence in the heart, giving us the opportunity, should we take it, to render devotional service to him. And this is the real reason why he's there, present in the heart, waiting for that opportunity, and we will take it. So, this is the glory of such festivals as we're having today, that the living entities get to dive into the nectar of confidential devotional service to Krishna. But one need not wait for any special day. That opportunity is there every day. As we said, the Lord is personally in the heart of everyone. He has also personally come as the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Right? We can explain in so many ways that he has come. Come as the deity. Come as even as this temple. Come as books. Come as prasadam. But particularly the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. This is the specifically mentioned avatar of the Lord in this age, by which he makes himself available to everyone without discrimination. It is no great labor to chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna,
Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
And the effect of this chanting is so transcendentally wonderful. So many verses describing the glorious effect of chanting the holy name. Di Shodashkam Kali Kalmasha Nashanam. The jiva, he's surrounded by so many layers of material nature, counted up in the Bhagavatam as Sorusha, 16. 16 layers. We have 5 kinds of active senses, 5 kinds of knowledge acquiring senses. We have 5 kinds of elements making up this gross physical body. Or actually, yes, elements also means sense objects. The object of the ears is akash, ether. The object of the eye is Agni, fire, we see. Yeah? So, in this way, the senses have the elements form these different objects of the senses. So, 5 kinds of sense objects, or 5 kinds of elements, this adds up to 15. And number 16 is the mind. The mind is the most formidable. The mind is the one which these other 15 are serving. So, but Kali Santarana Upanishad says, there are 16 names in the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, 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 Hare Hare. 16. 16 names, 16 coverings. The names attack the coverings! Vinashana means destroy. They attack and destroy. You can just imagine, like army attacking a walled city. 16 walls. This army is coming. Crash, boom, bam. One after the other, smashing down the walls until the jiva inside is liberated. So this is so wonderful, but it doesn't end there. This is the bringing of the living entity to liberation, but if we shall keep on chanting, we must keep on chanting, and then at the point of liberation, then the holy name of the Lord is bringing us again, as I've explained, into this confidential, loving relationship with the Lord. Namachintamani Krishna's Chaitanya Rasa Vigraha. This is Rupa Goswami. That the holy name of the Lord is a purely spiritual chintamani gem substance, and is the very form of our rasa relationship with Krishna. Now once, because there is still a practice in Bengal, particularly amongst sahajyas, the cheap pseudo-devotees, for what they call Siddha Pranali initiation. One goes to a guru and one is initiated into one's rasa with Krishna. The guru reveals that you are such and such manjari, gopi, or you are a friend of Krishna, or you're a peacock or something like that. And you get mantra and a name and you're supposed to meditate. So this is called Siddha Pranali, and this has been rejected by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. But still, this is kind of like a kind of folk tradition, one might say. It goes on. People think that this is what Vaishnava initiation is. And sometimes they go to Navadvip and they seek such a guru. So, at the time of Gorkhishor Das Babaji, he was a very, very, very famous as renounced sadhu, saintly person, always absorbed in Nam Bhajan, in chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So he would chant ceaselessly. And someone came seeking him. They heard about Gorkhishor Das Babaji. And they heard, of all Babajis, he is foremost. He is the one that one should seek out and render service to in the holy land of Navadvip, Mayapur. So this person found Gorkhishor Das Babaji and approached him humbly and said, "Babaji Maharaj, can you please reveal to me my swarup with Krishna?" Gorkhishor Das Babaji said, "Your swarup with Krishna will be revealed in the syllables of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra." And this is exactly what Rupa Goswami says, Chaitanya Rasa Vigraha. You want to know what is the Rasa Vigraha, the form, Vigraha means form, of your rasa with Krishna. You have to chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra on this higher platform above the modes of material nature. When this is passed beyond liberation, this is then Bhava Bhakti stage, Prema Bhakti stage. We have to keep chanting. Namachintamani Krishna's Chaitanya Rasa Vigraha. Puno Shuddha Nitya Mukta. He's going on the liberated platform. Binad Bam Nama Namino. And on this liberated platform, one understands that the name and the named, in other words, Krishna and his name, are the same. So this is a higher understanding of chanting Hare Krishna. So everything is there. A chant to become liberated from the modes of nature and chant to develop our eternal relationship with Krishna. So here, the holy name is now present in this dark age of Kali Yuga, personally introduced by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in the Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya, brought to all corners of the globe by Srila Prabhupada and his servants. So ample opportunity for everyone to take up the chanting. Nam namakari bahuna nijeshava shaktis tatrapata nimata smadane na kala. Na kala means no consideration of time, place, circumstance. Srila Prabhupada says, actually, the only consideration is that we should chant 24 hours a day. Someone wants to know, what is the rule of chanting Hare Krishna? So Srila Prabhupada explains, this was in an initiation lecture also. This is interesting. He's just initiating devotees into 16 rounds, and then immediately he's in the course of the initiation lecture saying, "And you should chant 24 hours a day." And Prabhupada insisted, "You can do it. You just simply need to practice." This is why we start with 16 rounds. So we can practice. But the eventual goal is to chant 24 hours a day, waking, sleeping, working, in any situation. One should always be vibrating the holy name of Krishna. And if one is doing this, that in itself is the proof of his love for Krishna, his realization of the non-difference between the Lord and his holy name, his taste, his taste for loving devotional service to Krishna. All of that is there. So, Krishna is manifesting as his holy name. So everyone can chant Hare Krishna. Such an easy process. And this way come to realize that Krishna, his name and his form are not different. Come to realize that the holy name or Giriraj, they're the same, identical. Namaste Girirajaya, Sri Govardhana Namani. I offer my humble obeisances unto Sri Giriraj, who is known as Govardhan. And then, what does it say in the next line? Just as I was saying, when we chant Hare Krishna, there are two purposes that are being accomplished. So the same thing is mentioned. Ashesha Klesha Nashaya. Nashaya again means to destroy. I quoted from Kali Santrana Upanishad, the same word. Nashaya, to destroy. Klesha means suffering. And Ashesha means unlimited. So, Lord Giriraj, Ashesha Klesha Nashaya. He is the destroyer of unlimited sufferings of the living entity. And Paramananda Dayane. Dayane means to bless, to bestow upon freely with open heart. So Dayane, what is he giving? Parama Ananda. Ananda, of course, means transcendental bliss. Parama means supreme. So this is Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mission also. Parama Karuna, Pahudvija. This Lochan Das Thakur, Parama Karuna, Pahudvija. Nitai Gaura, he's glorifying Lord Sri Sri Gaurnitai for their supreme mercy. Kevala Ananda Kanda, in the form of this unlimited Kevala. Kevala means unlimited, boundless, supreme Ananda, bliss that they're distributing in the form of the holy name, his Sankirtan process. So no one can, my point is that no one can complain that opportunity is not there. Krishna consciousness movement is widespread. So many millions and millions of living entities have been exposed to this opportunity. But the question is, will we take it? That's only the jiva can decide that. Jiva, he's very weak, but Shastra says he has one particular shakti, one particular power, tatasta. Tatasta. He can choose one side or the other side, Maya or Krishna. So that is up to us. Krishna is giving opportunity, even Krishna is forcing. Lord Nityananda in particular, he likes to force the living entities to take Krishna consciousness. Lord Nityananda's associates, Gopas, they're known as. And one of them, he had a very wonderful way of preaching Krishna consciousness. He would show anger. This is all transcendental, but he would show anger to those who are avoiding to take up the Sankirtan movement. Those who would turn away when there is kirtan, they would run down some alley to hide. And he would run after them with a whip. He would beat them with the whip. But when they were touched by this whip, they would become surcharged. Krishna Bhakti Rasa. And they would begin weeping and hair standing on end and chanting, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. It was such amazing pastor. Lord Nityananda and his associates manifest aggressive preaching. So that is there. So no one can accuse Krishna. Oh, you are holding it back, you are hiding it. But it is we who are avoiding. And in our avoidance, you see, this is because sometimes people say, yes, well, you're saying, you're talking about now, your 2003 Since Prabhupada came in 1965, so there's Krishna consciousness. But before, what about all these poor... But you see, when we avoid Krishna, namam duskritino mudha prapadyante naradama, then we create a non-devotional destiny. Then karma is seizing us. You see, we create a karma. And then karma is, it's simply a manifestation of our desire. And that is removing us from that opportunity. It's all a result of our own choice, our own desire. So now in this present situation, we should, as much as we can, take this opportunity and set up a course, a flow of destiny, which is bringing us closer and closer to Krishna. This is the glorious opportunity that we have right now. So, very humbly I encourage everyone to take advantage of the true meaning of this verse. Samoham sarvabhuteshu na me dveshosti na priyaha. I am equal to all of you, Krishna says. I am in everyone's heart. I am there, don't worry. And yeva janti tumam bhaktya. If you just render some service to me with a little devotion, maite teshu chapya. Then you become a friend, you are in me, and I am also a friend to you. This is his promise. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Shri Govardhana Puja ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Actually, there's a lot of time. So, yes, you have a question.
Now, what's actually the meaning of Girat? This is my first question. And the second is, what is the meaning of Shila? Where does it come from? Culture.
Giri means mountain, Govardhan mountain. Raj means king. So, Krishna, by lifting the Govardhan mountain, by defeating Indra, he established himself as the real Raj, the real king over everything. Indra is the king of the demigods, the managerial authority of the universe. But as my spiritual master was saying, that Lord Krishna showed that Indra, you are defeated by the little finger of my left hand. You see, generally, most people are right-handed, so the right hand is stronger. So, but Krishna lifted Govardhan Hill with his left hand, the weaker hand. And then, of the fingers on the hand, which is the weakest finger, the little one. So it was that finger that Krishna held the Govardhan mountain for 7 days. So he was showing Indra, you can't even surpass the little finger of my left hand. Oh, you'd be so proud that you are the king of the heavenly planets, the administrator, all that chatriya among the demigods. So this is the meaning of Giriraj and Shila. Shila means stone. So the Lord appears, as it is explained in the Shastras, he's appearing as particularly mentioned the Shalagram Shila. So this is referring to a stretch of the river Gandaki, which is flowing down from northernmost Nepal. There's a province, an autonomous province in northern Nepal on the border of Tibet called Mustang. And so the Gandaki River starts there and flows down. And in that stretch, there are these black stones in the riverbed. And these are, everyone is a avatar of the Lord. And he appears by his own sweet will, but he's also giving opportunity for devotees to go there and take him and worship him. The Shalagram Shila, there is no installation ceremony. It's not that the Lord has to be called to enter into the Shila. He is there. And he's simply there so that we can worship him. This is his mercy. And Govardhana Shila, same principle, but he's manifesting as the stones on the Govardhan Hill and around. And there's one particular
principle about Govardhan puja worship, Govardhan Shiva worship, is that one should not just go there and pick a stone and take it away. We do not have authority for that. But advanced devotee, one who is a Brajavasi, real resident of Vrindavan in the heart, he may give us Govardhan Shiva for our worship. That giving them, he's granting authority. You may worship the Lord in this way. Yes?
I heard that the Ma Mantra has 16 different meanings, 16 interpretations. Is that true?
Well,
does it also has it also to do something with Sita Ram or
One thing I will say is that Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he did not favor these different kinds of elaborate interpretations of the holy name. There was one pundit named Balabhacharya who used to like, he was a South Indian Brahmana and very learned. And very, he's nice, you see, devotee in one sense, but he's a little bit proud of his knowledge and he used to like to display knowledge. So this is not favored by Mahaprabhu and his associates. So one of the things that Balabhacharya used to want to do is to offer many different interpretations, explanations of the holy name of the Lord. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was not interested in this. So people may do that. They may say there are 16 or how many ever explanations of the holy name, but the first thing we know is Lord Chaitanya was not favoring that. What does Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself say? In Chikshastikam, Namnamakari Bahudha Nijisharva Shaktish. This is very, very deep statement. He's saying the Lord has hundreds and millions of names, and in every one of them, he has invested his transcendental potency. When you consider this, consider what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying. Hundreds and millions, countless, unlimited names of the Lord in the Vedas, but also in other scriptures outside of India, in different religions, there are names of God. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, the Lord has put his Shakti, his personal potency in every one of them. So then, the art is to how to derive this potency for the spiritual benefit of the living entity. So this is accomplished by being initiated into the chanting of the holy name of the Lord, the regulative principles that protect this chanting. So this is how we can access the Lord's potency. This is what we need to do. This is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying. Yes, unlimited names of the Lord. But what we need to know is that the Lord's personal potency is invested in every one of them. And also in the 10 offenses of the holy name, it is an offense to offer interpretation. So if one is explaining the holy name in so many different ways, that, you see, because it is speculative, if it becomes speculative, then it means it's becoming mundane, material, like an intellectual juggling of words. So then this becomes offensive. This is an aparad, an offense against the holy name. One of the 10 offenses. If we do this, then we lose our taste for chanting. You see? So one may be able to offer so many very grand sounding explanations of the holy name, but he has no personal attachment or attraction to chanting himself. So what is the use? This is what mundane scholars do. They proclaim, some mundane Indologist Sanskrit, I used to meet these people when I was on the Bhaktivedanta Book Trust library party in the 1970s, where we go to these universities and meet these gentlemen. And,